What if God calls us not to creeds, but to conversation?
What if God calls us not to a destination, but to a relationship?
What if God has been dreaming of a future with us and for us?
What if God urges us to be the answer, even in the midst of our asking of questions?
What if God longs for us to not only cry for justice, but to bear the burden of the hungry, the poor, and the oppressed?
What if we answer, "Here I am, I am ready"?
God, the Lord of sea and sky. Please join me in the opening prayer. Loving God, with open arms, you welcome all who call on your name and look to you in faith. No one stands outside the circle of your mercy and love. And so we come to offer you our worship, to declare that you are our God and that we are your people. Through the presence of the Holy Spirit, open our eyes to see you, open our minds to receive your truth, and our mouths to speak and sing your praise, now and until the end of time. Amen.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of the glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but in whole, it is nailed to the cross. And I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh, my soul. And Lord, haste that day when my faith shall be my sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, and the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall send. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh, my soul, it is well with my soul. Soul.
being with you the last 2 days, it is well with my soul. After that song, my soul is amazing. Thank you so much. Please hear the reading of the Gospel of Mark. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him, and the inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified 2 bandits, one on his right, one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha, you who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he's calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled the sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him away." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was ripped in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly this man was God's son." The word of God for the people of God. The year was 1899. I was only about 8 years old. You thought I looked old, but now I look really good, don't I? 1899, I was about 8 years old, and for a while now, everybody had been talking about the turn of the century. The 20th century this, the 20th century that. More than anything, people in Tinyville, Mississippi, where I grew up, thought God was going to do something new and exciting in this 20th century. I guess we thought God really liked round numbers. Some people started saying that God had chosen the 20th century for the time when Christ would return to the earth. They thought this was confirmed by the fact that a magazine had recently come out called The Christian Century. And the fact that maybe Yankees recognized it meant it had to be true. So the word spread like wildfire across Tinyville, and the whole town was convinced that Christ was coming back when the calendar switched from 1899 to 1900. You see, there's a lot of talking going on in a small town. Not a lot to talk about, but a lot of talking. Everybody talked. Old men playing pinochle down at the hardware store talked. Women at the quilting bee talked. Businessmen talked over coffee at Bonnie's Diner at 10:30 every morning during the weekdays, but they usually didn't talk about anything. They just chatted the smallest small town talk a small town could talk. So when something new, like Christ's return, comes along at the turn of the century, there's a lot to talk about, because I don't know if you know this, but the turn of the century only comes around every 100 years or so. The return of Christ, even less than that. So everybody was talking about it. And it didn't take long for everybody to agree that Christ was indeed packing his heavenly bags and would soon be arriving back on earth. But agreement didn't end the discussion. It just gave way to loads of speculation. When? Where? How would Christ return? Now, there was this one man in town, Mr. Romano, who didn't believe Christ was going to return in the 20th century. But that was no great surprise to the rest of us, because we all knew Mr. Romano was an atheist. So if you don't believe in God or Christ in the first place, why would you believe he was going to return? But that didn't stop him from joining the conversations. He would put himself in every chance he could get. And he could do this in the meanest ways because he was a mean man. I don't know whether Mr. Romano was cynical because he was an atheist or an atheist because he was cynical, but we young kids in town, we all knew to stay away from him. His house, little brown house, had big trees around it, leafy trees, so it was always dark in the house. And we knew that if you ever went into his yard, you would be invited to dinner. As dinner. We kids didn't have a great reputation in mind for him. But not only the kids, the adults held him in pretty low esteem as well. Every so often, someone would mention him at church, but it always would be to pray about him. Pray for his soon-to-burn-in-hell soul, that kind of talk, you know. But actually, that's not true. There was one good thing everybody said about him. Mr. Romano was the best photographer we knew. Now, you've got to remember, back in 1899, cameras were few and far between. They were very expensive. And as wonderful as these pictures were back in that day, you know, they had that grainy look to them, those black and white and tinted kind of thing. But if a picture is worth 1,000 words, one of Mr. Romano's pictures was worth 1,000,000 words set to music. He was an artist. So the town tolerated his meanness, his cynicism, his atheism, just so there'd be someone around to take good pictures of the mayor, take pictures of family reunions and weddings and newborn babies and stuff. But otherwise, no one really made any effort to socialize with him. No one tried to be friendly to him on the streets, even talk to him. And for the most part, that was just fine with Mr. Romano. Until all this talk about Jesus returning came up, and then he had to be in the middle of the conversations. He constantly mocked the town for its religious fervor. You think Christ is going to return? Do you know why that's not going to happen? Because there's no Christ, he would say. How can you think someone's going to come back when they never came in the first place? I'll believe Christ is coming back when I see it with my own eyes, not before. But his mockery didn't change anyone else's mind in town. Everyone believed that the turn of the century would mark the return of the Son of the Human One. In fact, Tinyvillians were so convinced that Christ was coming back that they started the discussion about when would Christ come to Tinyville. When's Christ coming to our town? And I remember at the dinner table one Sunday after church, by the way, we went to Resurrection Methodist Episcopal Church South, Daddy started talking to Mama about the men's Sunday school class that day, and they had started coming up with ideas of how to attract Jesus to come to Tinyville. Remember, I'm 8, 9, and I asked Daddy why anybody, much less Jesus, would want to come to Tinyville. After Mama said her usual Jackson Lewis Hillman, children are meant to be seen, not heard, Daddy said, well, actually, I think Jackson has a point. There isn't anything here to attract Jesus. We need to kind of holify the town somehow. We need to make it a place where Jesus wants to come. What would it take to make Jesus come here first? Just think of the prestige Tinyville would have. If Jesus came here first, we wouldn't be a no-name town anymore. It would be the holiest of holies right here. Just think of all the tourists we would attract. I don't guess any of us at the moment realized that there wouldn't be a tourism trade after Jesus had come. But there it was. And so my daddy took that question out, and people started asking this all around town. What could we do to attract Jesus to come to our town first? The editor of the local newspaper, the Tinyville World Scope, never was a paper more ironically named. The Tinyville World Scope put out a contest for people to come up with the best idea to attract Jesus to Tinyville first. What would it take to get Jesus there on January 1st, the stroke of midnight? Well, somebody suggested that the entire town should do something biblical, like put blood, lamb's blood, on the doorpost. Everybody was rallying around that idea until somebody said, well, wouldn't that make Jesus just pass over us? Miss Bonnie said we should change the name of the town from Tinyville to New Jerusalem. A lot of people liked that idea at first, but overall, it was decided it might be a little too presumptuous. What would happen, for instance, if Jesus didn't come here first, but came somewhere like Jacksonville down the road? And then Jacksonville would become the new Jerusalem, and we would be the old New Jerusalem. It's just too confusing. So we didn't go with the name. The idea that won the day was that the whole town should go together and put into Resurrection Methodist Church a new stained glass window, a glorious stained glass window, different than any other stained glass window ever seen before. Not just the most beautiful, it had to be unique. It had to be able to change in some way because Christ was coming to change everything. So the window itself had to somehow be able to transform. The town all jumped on this idea and decided, well, for something so unique, we had to get a foreign artist. So we brought someone all the way from California. This is what the artist came up with. He designed a square window. The panels could move along grooves. And you remember those kids' toys where you've got the little puzzles with numbers or a picture and you have to keep moving them around? That's what this window would be. You could move it all around. And the problem with that puzzle as a model for a window is there always has to be a blank space. So the artist had to somehow figure out how to use the blank space to its benefit. Well, the artist came up with a great idea, and when the window was finished, the picture was actually quite simple. It was a huge Jesus and a small town. Simple but elegant. The town was nothing special. Small, nondescript little buildings. But that Jesus, he was something. Huge, tall, thin. His hair was a deep golden brown that by contrast made his blue eyes just pop. In 1899, all Jesuses were white with blue eyes. Not only his skin, but his clothes were whiter than anything you've ever seen. The whitest white bleach could make. And his halo was so yellow, it looked like God had polished it with a cloud. During the morning worship service, when the clear day and the sun hit it just right, you couldn't look at the window. Jesus was too bright, too glorious. Now, the window was made of 15 sliding panels and that one empty space. So it was designed to be set up in one of two positions. So the first position had the town over here and Jesus over here looking like he was walking away from the town. And in the corner up here was the empty space. And of course there was a big glass panel behind it. And on that space was a road sign. The pole coming down in the rest of the picture, and the sign said Jerusalem. So in this position, the risen Jesus was leaving Jerusalem and heading back to Galilee to meet with the disciples. Now, when the panels were slid all around, it just switched things. Now, Jesus was on this side walking towards a small town. The panel was up there with the sign. The sign said Tinyville. The Jesus who had risen and left Jerusalem was now coming to Tinyville for the first time. So surely this would make Jesus want to come here first. The Franklin World Scope decided it had to have a picture of this for the front page of the paper. That meant they needed Mr. Romano. He was the only person who could make a black and white photograph of this glorious color window somehow have the power to convey its meaning. Well, when the editor tried to hire him, Mr. Romano laughed at him and said he would do it for free. He just thought the irony of the town having to hire an atheist they disliked to take a picture of the mystical Jesus they adored was payment enough for him. He had one requirement, however, and that was that he be left alone in the sanctuary to take the picture and do his work all by himself. He said he just wouldn't have busybody church people hovering over him like a bunch of clumsy angels while he was trying to create art. So the trustees of Resurrection Church reluctantly agreed to leave the pagan alone in their sacred space for a while, but they were going to stay outside the door the whole time. So one Friday afternoon around 9 o'clock in the morning, so he could catch the best light, Mr. Romano went in, closed the doors. Trustees sat outside the door for 6 hours. What in the world is taking him so long? But finally, after 6 hours, Mr. Romano opened the door and headed out carrying his equipment. Well, the trustees had a lot of questions. Well, did you get a good shot? Was the lighting okay? Are the pictures going to look good? What took you so long? Mr. Romano didn't even notice they were there. He walked out carrying his stuff and he was just muttering to himself, huh. He really is God's son. Who knew? He really is. The trustees were all amazed. At first, they just stood there staring at the open door, then staring at each other, until finally Mr. Peterson spoke up and said, "We did it!" He said, "We presented Christ's glory in such a way that even the town atheists had to acknowledge Christ's existence. Surely this will get Jesus here." Well, everybody was terribly anxious to see these photos. It took a while to develop them. Mr. Romano mailed them, for some reason, to the newspaper. When the editor got the package in the mail and knew what they were, he decided not to open them right away, but instead to invite the trustees of the church over to see them for the first time with him. So they all came to the house, and I got to go as well because the editor's son, Mark, and I played together. We were the same age. So we're outside swimming in the pond while they're in there, and all had a little snack, and now they open them, the packages, the photos. Not a single photo showed the window designed the way it was supposed to be. There wasn't one shot of Christ's resurrection in Jerusalem. There wasn't one shot of Jesus coming to Tinyville. Instead, Mr. Romano had just scrambled the window over and over again in different ways, all out of order, with Christ scrambled and mixed up with the city. In each photograph, there was that little empty space, but never where it was supposed to be with the road signs. Just, it made no sense. What's worse is none of the pictures were in focus. Jesus was all blurry, the town was all blurry. What in the world? Why did this take 6 hours? They spread all the photos out on the coffee table and looked at them in disgust. Not a good one in the bunch, someone said. I heard him say that because it was right at that point that Mark and I came in from swimming. Soon as Mark saw the pictures, he started walking up to them, and his dad said, "Young man, what are you doing here all but naked? At least wrap that towel around yourself. I've got guests here." Mark didn't really hear him. Mark looked at him and said, "These are great pictures." "Great," my daddy said. "Great. These are the worst pictures I've ever seen. Jesus is all messed up. Everything's out of focus. And Mark says, they're not out of focus. They're not out of focus at all. And he points at one of the photos. Everybody bends down to look at the photo Mark's pointing at. And through the empty pane, out in the world, something is clear. And everyone looks closely at it, and they realize it's a picture of Bart out on the street, on the corner of Main and Oak, begging for change, the only blind man in town. The trustees and the newspaper editor started rechecking all of the photos one by one, and sure enough, in every one, in that empty pane, there was something different to see that was in focus in the midst of the scrambled Jesus and the mixed up town. What the photograph showed depended on where the space was. In one, you could see a woman who was hemorrhaging for 12 years. In another, you could see a man in a cemetery possessed by a demon. In this one, you could see several hundred years of slaves working the fields of Mississippi. In one of the ones at the bottom, you could see dirty children coming out of the machine factory at the end of the day. Right next to it, you could see other children locked up in cages at the Texas border. There was one where you could see the people fighting and dying in Syria. Another one with a hospital wing quarantined with coronavirus patients. There was one where you could see blood on the floor of Mother Emmanuel and tire tracks in Charlottesville. And one more, you could see dead children lying on the floor of a school, but no one could make out which school it was because so many of them had experienced this. In every picture, Jesus was blurry and mixed in, but now you couldn't miss him. Well, after that second look at the photos, everyone in town quit talking about the return of Jesus. And every Sunday, the trustees scrambled the window in a different way, never the way it was originally meant to be. Being just a kid, I didn't really understand what had happened. So I finally just asked Mama, and I said, well, why aren't we worrying about Jesus coming back anymore? And Mama paused a minute, and she said, well, I guess it's because we realize he's been here all along. We weren't looking in the right place.
Thank you. Please join me in prayer. Let us pray for the breaking in of God's kingdom in our world today. Gracious God, because Jesus taught us to trust you in all things, we hold to his word and share his plea. We're nations budget for war, while Christ says, put away your sword. Where countries waste food and poison soil and water, while Christ says, I was thirsty, I was hungry. Where powerful governments claim their policies are heaven blessed, while Scripture claims that blessed are the meek. Where Christians seek a kingdom in the name of their own church, as if Christ came to build and not to break barriers. Where our prayers falter, our faith wanes, and our lights grow dim. Where and when Jesus Christ calls us.
Open our hearts to hear it, our hands to serve it, our hearts to hold it. Amen.
It has been a delight to be with you these 2 days. I know you all had other places to be and things to do and calls to fulfill, and I'm grateful you gave time to spend with me here. I'm grateful to those who invited me, the president, and all those who work behind the scenes, all the work with technology you don't see. Let's thank them. And now I wish for you, not that you just go forth and read Mark differently, which I hope you do, but I hope you find a new Christ daily in your lives, in places you would never expect. And I wish you Godspeed as you go, and know that the peace and call of God, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, will lead you on the paths you are to take. Amen.